Looking to improve your life, brush up on your personal growth techniques? You are in the right place. Welcome to Life's Little Lessons with your host, author of Designing Your Own Destiny, Kevin A. Dunlap.
Hello, everybody, and this is Kevin Dunlap, and welcome to Life's Little Lessons. And today I have a lady that I met at an event from just a few weeks ago, and I was actually on one of her episodes.
And this woman who has a phenomenal business and a phenomenal story, I just wanted to welcome her to our show. And her name is Annette Waters. She's a speech pathologist for her company called MySckool. And Annette, welcome to our show.
Thank you, Kevin. It's nice being on the show. I am very honored to be here, actually. It was great meeting you at the event and kind of getting to know you and learning more about your business. So thank you so much.
Well, it was phenomenal having another successful business owner on the show. And from what I gather, you have another company as well?
Yeah, I do. I actually have also a meal prep company, and we basically deliver healthy food to families, and we do catering events all over here in the Bay Area in California. And we just try to teach people how to have a healthy relationship with food, because I feel like people abuse food, whether it's they eat too little or they eat too much. And so that's really kind of another passion of mine, is just teaching people how to integrate food into their diet in a healthy way, into their diet in a healthy way, you know, so they don't feel like they're having to leave things out, but they are not depriving themselves, you know.
Now, is that vegetarian based or vegan based, or do you actually have meat in your meal plans?
Yeah, we actually have meat in our meals now. I'm leaning towards doing a plant-based meal prep company here within the next month or so, but I'm still on the fence about it because a lot of my clients right now are like, no. But, you know, it can be healthy too. You just have to get, you know, organic, you know, make sure you know where you're getting your meat from your vendors, and making sure that you're getting it, you know, organically. And meat's good for you also. It just kind of depends on what client base you're going for.
Well, when we originally met, we were mainly talking about your company called MySckool. Could you tell us a little bit about that? What is it and what do you do with it?
MySckool is a little bit more, I'm a speech therapist, but I consider myself an educator for kids. And I love to teach kids in the real world environment. I got into speech because I got a psychology degree, a bachelor's, and kind of didn't know where I was going next. My mom actually got brain cancer, and it was a little, she didn't have a stutter or anything, but I noticed that her speech was a little bit off when she first came out of surgery. And so I started looking into speech therapy, and it really, I was very attracted to it. So I decided that's the route I was going to go in. And I know that that was the job I was supposed to do. It's really rewarding to me. But my MySckool business was based off of the fact that I feel like kids need to learn in the natural environment and learning in the real world. So when I had my daughter, I basically just didn't have TV, didn't have video games, and I just taught her in the real world. And I really noticed a difference in her learning and maybe some of her friends' learning and her capacity to really retain information. So MySckool was kind of based off that concept. So I do speech therapy, I do academic counseling, I do parent advocacy all within the community. So I go to their house, so we may go to Boy Scouts or guitar lessons, and I help kids with special needs and general ed kids, you know, really be able to communicate effectively in those environments that they might have trouble with otherwise. Because most of the kids, they get their services in school, and a lot of those services are done in a speech room sitting at a chair with a therapist, and that's not really the real world. So they get out there and then they try to use those language skills with their friends or when they become part of a team or those social skills, and they just fall apart. I created MySckool, and MySckool basically is the complete opposite of that. It's basically putting them in those situations and going with them to whatever it might be that they're having struggles with and teaching them in the moment, because there's no better way to learn, I feel. And, you know, same with learning about math and science and all that. We may go to the grocery store and we'll learn about describing or science and weighing. I just feel like that's really how kids are going to retain the information when they're applying it. So that's what MySckool is based off of.
And how long have you been doing this for?
I've had my own practice for about 4 years, but 2 years ago, I left the public school system. I was a speech therapist there, and really kind of started getting this MySckool up and going. So I've had clients of my own for about 5 years or so.
Okay. Well, I would assume that you've been doing this with your own daughter as well.
Yeah. I mean, when I had my daughter, I knew that, you know, I wanted to obviously provide her with the best education, and what would that be? And I think public schools are great. Private schools are great. So I kind of tried a little bit of everything. She went to private school up until a few months ago. Now she goes to public school, and she loves it, you know, her new school. But I really just when we travel to Europe and all different places, and just really showed her how to learn that way, because I think it's more valuable. I mean, for me, you go to school, it's kind of like a socialization type thing, and then I'm really the one that's responsible for educating her. That's how I feel. So I feel like she's learned so much that she's really far ahead of her time as far as knowledge and being able to retain whatever information she learns. You know, she applies it, and that's a huge difference that most kids don't learn.
Well, with the plan you have right now, what kind of improvements have you seen in your parents' children as their mentor or their speech pathologist?
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, so I've worked with some kids. One of my clients, actually, I had in the school system. I've worked with him since he was in kindergarten. He's now in fourth grade. And so I work with him now in my company, not in the school system. And I've seen so much more improvements since I left the school to work with him in the community, because he wasn't getting that community base. And so he knows what to say in the speech room. Like, he has all the right dialogue and he knows the way he's supposed to act. But then, you know, he got into the real world and he just wasn't able to apply it. And so I've seen huge improvements for him to be able to be on baseball teams, for him to be able to do kind of one-on-one guitar lessons. He's going to join Boy Scouts. Even family events, you know, I went to a couple family events with them because he had difficulty communicating with his cousins. He would get really frustrated because he's on the spectrum and they didn't understand that. And so being able to give him tools with the family has made a huge difference. So it's really life-changing for the family also, because the parents kind of are pulling their hair out because they're saying, the school saying that he's doing so great. And then, you know, they get him in at home and he's, you know, a wild child or getting in trouble and can't join any of these teams that he wants to join. So it's, I definitely feel like it was the right way to go in my career, and there's a huge need for it. So I'm trying to expand it as well. I'm trying to get out there as many people as I can. Cause a lot of people don't even know that it's available for something like that, because there's not many speech therapists that do that, go into the actual community with them.
Okay, I can see that. By going into just an office, the kids are going to be in a very cold environment where they're not going to be able to express themselves fully.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. I mean, I had my own office and it was basically just like to interview the parents, more or less. It just isn't, it's just not helpful for the student. You know, I mean, we can go over it, we can role play as many times, but they're comfortable with you and there's no outside noises, there's no distractions. It's just not, you know, real life. And that doesn't mean that they don't grow in their speech classes at school. That's not, you know, what I'm saying, but they need something else. And a lot of that times it isn't out there, especially insurance providers. They're not providing that for, you know, students these days. It's really limited on who gets insurance. So the parents are kind of at a loss for what to do. So yeah, I mean, I've seen it take huge leaps and bounds. You know, I've also incorporated some of my fitness and nutrition with them also, and being able to kind of integrate it all. And that's really helped with their diet, because diet has a lot to do with your energy levels and, you know, the way that you're feeling and your tiredness, which also affects your communication, obviously.
What kind of signs should parents be looking for before they could reach out to contact somebody like yourself?
Well, I mean, I work with mainly kids with special needs, but I've also worked with general ed kids. So it really can be any, if your child's having difficult, like behavior difficulties, you feel like in the community, or they're not fitting in at school, they're having difficulty making friends, if they're not understanding, you know, basic concepts, or if they're bored. That's another thing. You know, a lot of kids these days are playing video games and they're getting that instant gratification. Well, then they go to school and the teacher's not able to give that to them. So they're bored and they're, it's taken as they're not smart or they're not able to do the work. And it's really just, they're not engaged. And so being able to provide those other learning opportunities really is able. And then for me to write a report to add to maybe a progress meeting that they're having is also helpful for the parents. So really it's a huge realm of the kids that I work with. I mean, I work with very severe kid, you know, special needs kids to kids that, you know, you wouldn't never even know had any difficulties, but sometimes it's just social awkwardness. They may not be able to make a friend or initiate a conversation. And so it could be something like that. But it's also sometimes parents just don't have patience to take their kids to these things and kind of work through it. And so that's where I come in. And yeah, I mean, it's really anybody. I think it's just, you know, if they have questions, they can call. I mean, that's what I tell people. If you are questioning something, then you should reach out to somebody, because you're questioning it for a reason. Parent has kind of a gut instinct about what's going on with their child. So I always just say it's better safe than sorry. Call.
When you say behavioral challenges, are you also referring to people with ADHD and autism and things like that?
Yeah, that's one of my, autism is my specialty. I helped open a autism center for adolescents in Sacramento. That's where I went after I graduated. And what we did there is kind of the same thing that I'm doing now, but it was in a a clinical setting where, or in a big, at Sacramento State, it was in a big gym. And we just provided different activities. So we would like set up if we were going to Boy Scouts or if we were going to this, and we would just teach them in the moment. So that's kind of my specialty is, you know, the kids on the spectrum and ADHD. I have a love for these kids because they're really misunderstood. I had a couple kids in the school that I worked at that really got to my heart. So that's kind of what I'm studying now is how it impacts their learning and how different learning environments can really help them as far as they can't sit in a chair and then they get in trouble for not sitting in their chair. And so they're not able to learn. So I'm really trying to be able to get into schools to help teachers understand that there, you know, there are differences and that if we change the way that we teach, then maybe the kid isn't really the problem. Maybe we just need different teaching styles.
And this kind of reminds me of a documentary of a, or even a commercial of a documentary that I saw. It was conducted by that guy, that really big guy from Welcome to Columbine.
Oh, yeah. I don't know his name, though, but yeah, I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's Michael Moore. You know, he was doing this documentary about these schools in Finland where the kids are only in school half the time, but they're learning twice as much. And it was all just based on how the kids just interact.
Right. That's the old way. You know, you have to be able to change and adjust to the new times. I mean, there's half the kids in the classroom have some kind of special need, right? Every kid's unique. That's how I look at it. So why not integrate everybody and have different learning styles? But, you know, teachers are, you know, they're set in their ways sometimes, especially if they've been doing it for 20 years. Right. So, it's kind of hard to, you know, change those ways. So that's why, you know, I left and do my own thing. And then I just know that I'm able to help. Yeah. And ADHD is at those parents, I'm telling you, they're godsends. You know, it's a difficult thing to deal with.
Now, when you're dealing with people with ADHD, and I'm not a parent here, so I don't know this much about this, but have you noticed or seen them, see the kids actually reduce the amount of pharmaceutical medication that they're on?
Yeah, so there's, and forgive me, I can't think of his name right now. I've worked with a doctor. He actually helps kids with ADHD get off the medication by doing different types of therapy and using holistic supplements, which I'm a true believer in. Now, I'm not completely against medication because there are some kids that you've tried everything and finally you're just like, I just don't know. And it works, you know? So I think it's for every individual, but I'm definitely more of a holistic approach. I've definitely helped, I don't know, a handful of kids definitely get off of medication from just being able to teach them in the actual moment, because that's what they're missing. Their impulse is they can't control that impulse. And so you can teach them all you want in a classroom or in a speech room, but when they get out there, they just don't have the strategies to control that impulse, and it's not their fault. And so if you teach them in the moment and you give them those strategies, then it's kind of integrated into their mind where it just becomes natural rather than, okay, what did my speech therapist tell me I was supposed to do? And you have to think of it, you know? So yeah, I mean, I've definitely helped with that. That's another passion of mine, is because, you know, I don't want kids out there kind of medicated and, you know, groggy, and it's just, and some of them gain weight. There's just so many different things that come with it.
And it's more than just what's going on the outside. It's also what's going on the inside, like their kidneys or something else like that.
Oh, so much, so much. It's like, yeah, I mean, there's so many other approaches, but the, you know, pharmaceutical ways, they just, you know, they don't want to tell you that because they're going to lose their money.
Well, I definitely see about the pharmaceutical companies, but I'm more talking about the patient itself.
Well, exactly. And they don't educate them on that. So that's kind of like my mission, you know, is just to kind of get the word out there. And I advocate for parents, you know, they can call me for a free advice anytime. I'm very familiar with like it's IEP system. So a lot of kids with special needs have an individual education plan. So I'm very familiar with that and very, have a passion for helping parents, because a lot of times what happens is they get this IEP, which is this huge document, and they've never seen it. And then they go in and people are telling them all this stuff. And then they're like, sign here. And it's kind of like you're getting bullied in, and you don't even know what you're signing for. Mm-hmm. And so I really have passion for helping parents understand what's going on and what is available to them. Because a lot of times the services are available and they don't know.
Well, thank you for enlightening me. I did not know that people like this even existed until the day that we met, or actually even more so until right now today.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just didn't know anything until now. Yeah. I never would have even known, even to have even thought to look for somebody like you.
Yeah. It's, you know, it's funny. They, people say, oh, you help people with their speech, like articulation, you know, say the S sound or, you know, have a stutter. And I'm like, that's like this much. And we, you know, our whole, like what we actually do is gigantic. So thank you for having me on here so I can spread the word.
My pleasure. And I'm looking at your website right now, and going by the pictures that I see he mainly has kids on there. So is that who you mainly work with? Is it just children?
You know, I've worked from infants to adults, you know, adults with like brain cancer or memory loss. I also volunteered to do that just because my mom passed away of that. So, but my passion is younger kids because I feel like they have so much they want to learn, you know, and they're willing, they don't have those set ways yet, you know, whereas you go to high school, you know, they're not so much willing to change and to learn. They have to have that, you know, really powerful why. And so I do work with all levels, but that's just why there's so many pictures, because that's really where my passion is, because it makes me happy to see them grow and to change. And that's the age when they're willing to do that, you know? And that's really when parents seek a lot of help, is that younger age in elementary. So a lot of times if you get private practices, the majority of them are going to be using elementary school because the parents are reaching out so early.
And that's when the problems are getting noticed, is because they're no longer with mom and dad anymore. They're now in a classroom setting where they have to be sitting up straight and paying attention to a teacher.
Yeah, and the teacher. And then, you know, it's a different perspective, because as a parent, you're like, oh, my kid's fine. You know, and then they go into school and then they bring something up that you didn't even notice, or you wouldn't, because you're a parent, you know, or you kind of close your eye to, right? Because you're like, oh, it'll work itself out, you know, so. Usually around kindergarten, unless it's something more severe, it's kindergarten or first grade, because they really start seeing those difficulties being able to sit in a chair or socialize or learn, you know, also.
And that's commendable. And I'm assuming everything is okay with your child as well. Is that correct?
My child? No. No, it was when my mom first got brain cancer. She didn't have full-on speech, but her speech was definitely impacted because obviously her brain got opened up. And it was just interesting to me to see her process of herself, of like really kind of teaching her, you know, how her mouth moves and being able to say the sounds right and not stutter her words or slur her words. And so I didn't even know speech therapy existed at that point. And so I just started researching it, and I was looking for my next degree, because in psychology, you can't really do much with it until you have your next degree. I learned that at a young age too. And so then I just went into that field, because I knew that was, and as soon as I started, it was like a match made in heaven. I knew that's what I was supposed to do. So to this day, it's just, it comes natural to me, and I love it, you know, because the kids, you know, they need so much love and so much help, you know, they need just people nurture them. So they don't always get that at home, and they don't always get that at school. So there's me, Superwoman.
Well, thank you for helping people out like that. That's really awesome. And not only are you making a change in the kids' lives, but you're also making it in with the family and even the community.
Yeah, it's pretty rewarding. You know, I had a kid that's now in high school that I worked with when he started in high school, and he just contacted me. He's come so far. He's like, you know, captain of the football team. And before, he couldn't even talk to kids when I first started working with him. So it's good to see, you know, this huge transition of all my kids now.
And yeah, they really are kind of just like your kids, aren't they?
Yeah. I check in with them. Are you doing your homework? Are you doing this? You know, how is the girl situation?
I guess now is a good time to go ahead and get started with some of the other questions that we normally ask on our show. So let's actually talk about some successes. And this is going to be in particular just to your MySckool program, not your other program or other company that you have. Could you tell me about some of your early successes with your company?
Early successes, I think, you know, they came at a slow pace, you know, but there's also quite a lot now, because I look at it as definitely when I was very lucky in Sacramento when I started my career to have met a gentleman to help open the autism center, because I had just gotten my degree, and he was a doctorate at Sacramento State, and he taught me so much about being a therapist and communicating and writing goals that are actually measurable and beneficial for the student. And so I think that was my first early success, is meeting him, because he really paved the way for my success now. I mean, most people don't have their own practice 6-7 years into being a speech therapist, you know? So he really, I think, set the way for that. So I'm very grateful for that. And then just really successes as far as just finding people and mentoring people. You know, I really find that my success kind of comes from helping others, and I really thrive on that. And so I give back a lot to the speech community and to new students that are in the program, because there was a million times I wanted to quit and I said, I'm quitting tomorrow and I'm never going to make it, you know? So I just like to show them and mentor them and have me put them into different sites and for them to get those hours that they need to show them that you can do it, because here I am, you know? So those are my successes, I think. There's a few kid successes. I had a girl that was selectively mute. which most people relate to having an early traumatized experience. And that wasn't the case. She basically was very, very verbal everywhere except for the minute she stepped on campus. And so I worked with her for, I don't know, 3 or 4 years, you know, and it was amazing to hear her speak at school with me and laugh and giggle. And that I'll never forget. You know, she's now in sixth grade and communicates on her new campus almost the first day, which was huge, you know, because she's massively terrified of people. That's what we found out. So that's probably one that sticks with me the most. And the captain of the football team, you know, he calls me every week, but that's different, you know? So there's just many, there's all the time every day, you know, because kids grow so much and they learn and they want to share their successes with you. So that's what's also great, you know, like with adults, they're kind of like, eh, even if you do great things for them, you know, they're not really excited about it or, you know.
You know, we kind of beat ourselves up. However, if we could just go out there and celebrate our successes.
Right. You know, and I mean, I had this one grumpy old man. He had a stroke and then his wife brought him in and he did not want to take any advice from me, who was, you know, 40 years younger than him or something. I don't know how old he was, but he was so stubborn. But by the end, she goes, tell her what you told me last night. And he said, well, this was the best choice I ever made. So, you know, he could be grumpy, but it still worked out because he got his memory back. You know, I mean, he was forgetting everything. He was forgetting what a cup was called and he just needed some, you know, like, word memory games and to really just trigger that, activate the brain in that area. And his wife couldn't do that. She says, I don't know what you need. And so yeah, that was kind of a cool thing. But yeah, I mean, I love my job. I get success stories on probably too often.
With successes also comes challenges. Are there any kind of challenges that you would like to share?
You know, I've been pretty lucky because I kind of just got clients from being in that community. So I've been pretty lucky in that sense. Challenges was, you know, starting a fitness center and a meal prep company in between quitting my job and kind of wanting to do the speech thing. And so that's been a huge challenge because I put my focus on that. And so finding my way back to my, not that that's not a passion, but my real passion of why I left my job 2 years ago has been kind of a challenge because it was hard to go to the Las Vegas conference and speak about my school business because I hadn't spoke about it for so long. It was really hard. Every time I got up, I wanted to speak about Enjoy Food, which is my other company. And it was really challenging, you know? So I think that's been my biggest challenge with the speech company or the speech practice is building it honestly for me, you know, I kind of did the gym and the food thing for so many other people because they needed it rather than what I really wanted to do. So kind of trying to stay focused has been a challenge.
And I'm glad that you're saying that because there are going to be people on this show that are brand new entrepreneurs and they're going to be going through some very similar challenges.
Yeah.
And it's actually just getting outside of your comfort zone and just go and do it.
Right. You're only going to learn. Oh, sorry about that. You're only going to learn by doing it. You know, I mean, I was so afraid of failing, you know, or I learned from that conference. That was the biggest thing. I had to go to that conference to let go of this other company that's taking my time. And going to that conference really made me see that there's so many other entrepreneurs out there. I mean, there was 500 people there or something, right? And everybody was talking about this business failed and now I'm doing this business. And it's like, it's not really, you know, Allison taught us, it's not that you're failing. It's that you've learned from it and you've grown from it. And without that experience, you couldn't have the next one. So it really helps me kind of be okay with letting go and knowing as an entrepreneur that you did your best, you know? And it's not even that the other one's failing. I'm choosing to do this, you know, do another business. So it's kind of, you know, I mean, entrepreneurship is hard. It's very hard. You know, you're kind of, you have to network and you have to get out there because otherwise you're alone and that's scary.
That is what's great about going to one of these conferences or these events is that you meet other like-minded entrepreneurs. Like I live here in Las Vegas and you live there in the Bay Area.
Yeah.
And the great thing about that is you have these networking of other entrepreneurs that you can have as a support system. And it's like what you had said about the ninth grader, just every week or every so often call in and check in. And they may still be paying or not paying you anymore, but it's always a good idea just to go ahead and just call up and just check in. And you're doing that check-in just to help people stay motivated and connected. And these conferences don't have to be all that expensive. Like this one was just under $500.
Right. And it was like $1 million worth of information.
Yes.
It was amazing.
Go to those events and they will be very helpful. And let me give you the secret formula here. They are going to upsell you.
Yeah, exactly.
They will.
Don't think they're not going to try to sell you something because they are.
But think about it. If you are putting your own program on and you're doing it as low cost as possible to be maybe even break even, you are going to be wanting people to buy into your stuff that is 10, 15, 20% of the room, which will convert. And here's the other thing. You are going to be learning something from this event that you're going to, even if it's just one little tidbit of information. And don't forget also that you'll be meeting other entrepreneurs. And the stuff that you will learn could be very integral in your business. I know for me, since the event, I've done quite a few things differently.
Yeah.
And even on the pre-interview before this call, for about 20 minutes, Annette and I were talking some very techie stuff. Well, it's actually me doing the talking, but it was stuff I probably would not have implemented if it was not for that program. And it sometimes was stuff I've heard 30 times already. However, I guess I just didn't learn it. So it's now time for me to implement it. And sometimes I think about, why don't I just do this the first time?
The information they give you is, you know, it's definitely immeasurable. I mean, I knew going in there that I wasn't going to be spending the top dollar like most of them. And I was very honest when we had the, you know, 15 minute talks, and it was great because I already knew what I was going into, but I didn't get any less out of the conference because of that. You know, I mean, there's times when I've gone and I've bought every product, you know, that was there because I was able to at the time. But, yeah, I mean, it's just kind of, you just kind of go. I mean, that's why I think people are like, oh, I can't spend the money. I can't do this. You just have to go. You have to find a way, because that's what you change your career.
And at this event, everybody in the class had a chance to have a 15-minute talk with one of the coaches. And the coach I got set up with, I actually knew from another company. However, this was very life-changing. And he ended up, when I was talking with him, he actually ended up giving me a formula to follow. And this formula was huge for me, how I looked at how I could be building my business. And I cannot wait to share this with you. And this formula will really impact your business. And when Phil was actually sharing this with me, it was in less than a 5 minutes part of our conference. This formula is a very simple formula. So for those of you out that are listening, I suggest you write this down. But if you don't have paper or pencil handy at the moment, it's pretty easy to remember. And the formula is V plus C equals P. That is V as in Victor plus C as in Charlie equals P as in Paul.
V plus C,
What the V stands for is visibility. What visibility do you have? Are you writing blogs? Are you doing podcasts? Are you doing stuff on stage? Maybe even writing a book? Anything that shows you off to the audience.
Mm-hmm.
The C stands for credibility.
Mm-hmm.
Credibility can come into the forms of, again, writing the blogs, the podcast, getting out there. Having a book is a great way to show credibility. Annette Waters, having the label of being a speech pathologist, right there builds credibility. Then there's the equal sign, and then you have the letter P, which stands for profitability. Therefore, what that means is the more visible that you are, the more credible that you are, is going to be equal to the more money that you will make.
Right. So, that's all you got to do.
The same is seen if somebody was trying to lose weight. And these four words that a mentor of mine gave to me over 8 years ago has resonated with me. And those four words for the losing the weight was, eat less, move more.
Yeah, exactly.
There you go. Or more calories than you're taking in.
Exactly. Yeah.
And one thing I do want to say is that the podcasting does give me a lot of visibility.
Right.
And then it's all about the consistency, making sure your show gets out there on a regular basis. And then that also leads to your greater SEO that you're going to get from your show. And then that is where your credibility comes from. And then this leads into other speaking engagements, like at National Speakers Associations or Toastmasters, which just increases my visibility as well.
Yeah.
And with all of that combined, that leads into more profitability.
And that's the thing, you got going to the events is one thing, and then putting it into action is another. You know, I mean, I've gone to events and then I come home and then a month later, I'm like, wait, I didn't do anything. You know, I've learned my lesson about doing that. But, you know, this event, and anybody, I don't know if you're promoting it, but if anybody can go next year, I mean, it's life changing. It really is. I feel like it's really got something with that event, you know? But yeah, this is the action part of it, you know?
And if you want to know more about that event, just contact me directly at kevin@kevinadunlap.com. That's Kevin, K-E-V-I-N, at K-E-V-I-N-A, D as in dog, UNLAP.com. And the name of the lady that we've been talking about, her name is Allison Maslin. And just go ahead and just send me an email and I'll put you on our mailing list. And therefore, you'll be notified of any events like hers or other people that are coming up in the very near future. Now, Annette, as we're getting back onto the script, let's talk about some of your early fears. What were some of the first things that were holding you back as you were just getting started, regardless if they were real or imagined?
I think just being successful, you know. I had clients in when I had my, you know, I'll say my steady job, you know, your 8-to-5 job in the school system, making all kinds of money, and then to do your own thing. So I always had that, but I was always just scared to take a leap. Oh my gosh, I'm going to quit my job. And then what? And then how can I provide for my daughter? And it was just, it was really frightening, you know, it really was frightening to think, okay, well now I'm the only person, how am I going to make this happen? You know? So that was the scary part. Will I be able to get enough clients? How will I do it? I've never had my own business. I mean, this is almost 2.5-3 years ago now. So, I mean, I've come so far, but I didn't have the network I have now. You know, I started the speech business and you just kind of network within the educational network, you know, versus when I started the gym, the fitness center and the meal prep company, I ventured out to everybody. And that really is what helped me get over my fears, because I took business advice from everyone because I didn't know, you know, I mean, running a speech business is pretty simple. I mean, I do my clients and, you know, I do my own books. It's not very complicated, you know, but when you get into other businesses, like I have, it can be very complicated. But just one, I think being successful was my number one fear. Well, providing for my daughter was my number one fear, and being successful because I wanted to show her that she could be anything she wanted to be, and that, you know, as long as she believed she could do it. So if I didn't do it, then what does that show her? So that was another fear for me, is just showing her that it's possible. And then just being alone, you know, like working in the schools and working on teams for so long, when you're a speech therapist, you always need something new comes up, and to not be able to have anyone to bounce an idea off of was kind of frightening. But then realizing you do have people, I do have connections, you know, just reaching out to them, because even though you're not on campus with them and can talk to them face-to-face, it doesn't mean that they're not there. So I think just not wanting to feel alone, and, you know, being successful for them to show my daughter was the main thing. But that's all taken care of now, so I have different fears.
And with that being said, are there any recent fears that you'd like to share with the audience?
I really want to, my fear of, I have a control issue. That's how my food company all is letting go, you know. I really am passionate about what I do. And so I provide I provide quality service, and I know that I make an impact on these kids' lives. And so expanding my business is scary, because how do I know that they'll provide the same thing I am, you know, but they'll provide it because I'm going to train them and they'll be trained by me. So hopefully, you know, I don't have to have that fear. I gain that confidence at the conference. You know, I can't be the only one in the business, otherwise it won't grow. So just letting go of that fear of, like, I have to do everything is huge. And I've started doing that. You know, I've started allowing people to help me with my website and all these different piece by piece slowly. And so it's helped a lot, you know, not having to do everything, which is like impossible. And then I think, again, just having that balance, you know, I work a lot. And so the fear of not having that balance once I grow it, because, you know, I'm slowly letting the food business go. And so I'm going to have more time. And then am I going to fill that with this business, you know, and growing it? I don't know. That's another fear, is not being able to find that balance, which is a big, you know, I mean, I think that's every entrepreneur's fear. Cause I work 24 hours a day. If I could, I would, you know, to build it, which is not healthy. So.
Well, you do need that at least 4 hours of sleep.
Right. Yeah. That's about average what I get. So yeah, there's new fears. I mean, as you get bigger and you grow, you're always going to have new fears. But if you don't face them, then you're not living. So that's how I look at it. Might as well just go for it.
And I'm proud that you did that. Now, when you left the school system, was that a slow process, or did you just up and quit one day?
Well, you know, it's interesting. It was kind of just one day, and I was just working with this kid, and I was just so frustrated by the teacher not responding to the therapy plans and whatnot, and the kid constantly being in trouble. That I just was like, I can't do it anymore. And so I said, I quit. I sent my notice in, and they're like, what do you mean you quit today? And so I actually sent my notice in October, but I stayed the whole entire year. So I didn't leave until June. But they kept asking me every month, are you sure? And I did not change my mind that whole entire time. So I knew it was a drawn out process because I told them that I would stay, because it would be very hard to find someone to replace me. And I love my kids, so I didn't want to leave them high and dry, you know?
But then at least they gave you some time to start building your own business.
Exactly. But I knew that day I have to go. I didn't give any less, you know, I gave the same great service, you know, or, you know, provided for the kids, but I knew that day I was just had to go. So because it's ethical issues, you know, it's like the way I believe to teach and the way some of the school systems have to teach because it's the state law, it just doesn't align. So it wouldn't be ethical to stay there.
Oh man, that'd be good.
I am glad that you held your ground and made that decision, but you also stayed true to the students, because that wouldn't, in my opinion, would have been a take to those students by you just up and quitting with very little notice.
Exactly. I mean, many teachers stay in because the longer you stay, then you get, you know, you get your tenure and then you, you know, you're locked in. And it's like, that's not really why I'm in the educational field. I feel like if I wasn't happy, then the kids aren't going to be happy. So I think it was just something. Yeah. I mean, it is the best decision I made for my life. Put it that way. I'm able to be there and pick my daughter up from school. It's just a huge difference in everything. So if anybody's out there, you know, is questioning it, you just got to go for it. You know, you really do, because you'll find a way, you know, it's like fight or flight, right?
And in my opinion, there is always another way. But now you also gave yourself plenty of time to not only build your business, but also do all the other things like create a website, create a program, and start getting new clients. Or even having some of the students that you currently were working with to be work with you privately, unless that was a conflict of interest or something like that.
It was a conflict of interest. They don't want you to do that. So I did not approach any of those. But as soon as the day I left, they all came to me. They approached me. So I wasn't working for them anymore. So it was okay. But yeah, I mean, I definitely stayed ethical to, you know, to my job and to my practice and whatnot. I was going to say, I forgot. Maybe I'll remember before the end.
I'm sure it will come back to you.
Okay.
Well, you have shared your successes. You share some of your fears and some of your challenges. But I think we learn most from our setbacks. These are the things that we can perceive as failures. Would you be willing to share with some of your early failures in your business?
Don't start three businesses at one time. it kind of wasn't by choice. It just ended up happening, right? I was like making clean meals for people, and then it just turned into this company, and then I was training people, and it just turned into this gym. It was like not on purpose. So yeah, don't ever do that, anybody. And you know, just failures of having to do it all myself, you know, it really impacted a lot of my businesses. So instead of my businesses being number one, they're maybe like number three or four, you know, because there's not enough time for it to be number one. Because you're getting pulled each and every way. And, you know, just build one and make it great and then sell it or move on or have somebody else run it and build another one. That's what I've learned. Because you can't do it all, you know, and use other people. I was building my websites, doing my books. It's just because you think you're saving money, but you're not. You're just pulling your hair out and it's just making you crazy.
And that is very true. And if you're having trouble hiring people, the best thing to do is just to start on the small side. Maybe hiring a virtual assistant to help you with some small mundane tasks. As an example, you could go to websites like fiverr.com, that's fiverr.com, to have them do something as simple as designing your business card. And once you get in the habit of hiring people out, then it becomes second nature when you need to actually expand your business and you have to get that first independent contractor, that 1099 employee, or even hiring that first W-2 wage earner. And this reminds me of a previous guest that's been on our show that she actually hired her first personal assistant way before she could even afford that personal assistant. However, that personal assistant has actually saved her tons and tons of time and even money.
Right.
And she will tell you to this day that hiring that personal assistant was one of the best things that she's ever done. It allowed her to expand her business quicker as well as to get more clients more frequently.
And that's what they tell you, not all the business advice. Everybody was, you know, telling me these things, but I never followed it. And I listened, I'm like, yeah, I got to do that this week. You know, I got to find somebody to help me. And, you know, I'm telling, that's the best advice I could give people. Listen to the people that have already done it, you know, because they know they're telling you this for a reason. And you just get burnt out, you know, and then nothing's going to be successful. And so that's why I went to the conference to reset myself. And it worked, you know. So, I mean, if you're ever feeling like that, you just got to go be around other entrepreneurs and you got to find a great conference or seminar or something, and it really will refocus, you know, just really go and refocus. But I think that's like my one thing, my lesson learned is just try not to do it all. You know, there's people out there that are willing to help and accept their help, you know, because if I'm in the kitchen all the time, I can't build my business. That's what I've learned with.
And that's one thing that you definitely have to consider is, in your particular case, you did not have another form of support system in place. You did not have a husband or somebody else to help take care of you. So you were there completely responsible for yourself and your daughter.
Yeah. So it's been it's been fun. It's definitely been a road to travel, very long, but, you know, I'm finding, you know, I'm starting to listen and grow this business now. So it's definitely a lot better. Yeah.
And that is such a very noble thing that you were doing. So Annette, where do you see yourself in the next, say, 12 to 24 months from now?
So my goal, you know, for the next 12, 24 months, let's see, so 1 to 2 years is really having, I say 2 employees, maybe more, but that's my goal for the next 12 months is to get 2 employees or 2 other clinicians that feel passionate about educating the way I do. Because I think that it's a huge thing, you know, if you believe in education one way, then you can't teach it the other way, you know? So really people that have the same vision as I do is really important to me. And that's not always easy to find because you come from a college that's educating you to learn a certain way to teach this certain way, you know? So it really has to be, you know, kind of open-minded. So that's why I'm getting out there and volunteering more into the colleges and whatnot to kind of let everybody know about this way of teaching. It's so the kind of like the learn, create, share kind of model where they're doing now in a lot of the schools, it's kind of like a hands-on thing. They're doing more class interactives and then they're sharing about it. They're kind of gearing that way, you know? So you are seeing a lot of changes and that's being taught in the colleges now. So that's great. So that is one plus side. But for me, it's like, I wouldn't want a school without walls. That's my vision. It's like, you can go, the world is your school. So we could go anywhere. There's actually, I want to say, it's on my website too. There's a YouTube video. If anyone wants to learn about this, it's called Hacking My Education. And it's a TED Talk. It's this kid. I think he was like 12, 13 maybe at the time. He's amazing. He talks about his parents pulling him out of school and homeschooling him and how he hacks his education. This talk will change your world. I'm telling you, if you have kids and you're wondering about it, he really just talks about the impact and how everybody judged his parents on taking him out of school and homeschooling him. And he was kind of upset, you know, because he was leaving his friends and he didn't realize the world that he was about to create. Now he's like a known professional kind of skier too. So I've kind of been following him on Instagram and stuff. So that really was another, you know, he was only like 12 at the time. I think what really was a passion of mine, I just kind of followed what he said, you know. He said that a lot of times when people ask you, what do you want to be when you grow up? And everybody comes up with like astronaut and all these different things. And he's like, nobody ever says happy. You know, he's like, that's what I wanted to be. I wanted to be happy. And my parents gave that to me, you know? And so I think it's true to that, to stay true to that. It's just, we don't know what these kids want. We don't know what they want to learn. Everybody learns differently. So until they find out, just let them, you know, explore the world. So that's really what my vision is kind of getting that message out there and finding 2 other people to help me because I can't do it by myself.
and there's so many logistics things out there that you can do. And as you're hiring more speech pathologists to join your company that are in alignment with what you're looking to do, then of course you're able to help more people and thereby growing your business. Or it could even be a personal assistant or other people that are in the admin department.
Exactly.
And taking on those employees is going to be a very big step. And there's many of entrepreneurs out there that are very hesitant on taking on that first step of hiring an employee because they just don't want the headache of having an employee.
And that's why I haven't yet. And it's like, I got to change that behavior if I'm going to be successful. You know, you just really have to. And whether it's a clinician or somebody else just to help me with all the other stuff, it's just two employees somehow, some way to help me grow, you know.
Now, any other upbeat moments that you want to share about being an entrepreneur?
Yeah, there's so many. I think, you know, never, you know, I say take every opportunity that you can. You know, I welcome meeting everybody. I go to networking events at least twice a week. I belong to 2 networking groups. I just really, the visibility part, right? And for me, it's about, that's how I learned how to grow a business. You know, I didn't know anything about business and I welcome everybody's advice. You know, it's kind of like Skittles. You know, I tell everybody, I'm like, I take it all in. There's all these different flavors and then I just take out the people that I want and the other ones I don't, I just throw it, right? So it's like, it doesn't matter if you don't agree with their opinion, it's just a matter of hearing it, you know, and you never know who's going to have that one piece of information for you. So really just getting out there and networking. I mean, that's what's kind of saved me through all this, and not being fearful of trying new things. You know, I think that's what stops a lot of us, is like, we have these great ideas as entrepreneurs, right? We're creative and we come up with all these things, but then we're so afraid of, you know, implementing it, or we don't have the time to implement it. It's like, you just got to do it, you know? And then that's where your success comes from. Because when I'm hesitant, you know, I follow that 5 second rule. You know, there's that book, the 5 second rule, genius book. You're going to know if you can't decide in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, then maybe you shouldn't do it. So that's kind of like my rule of thumb. But yeah, I mean, I don't know, just go and take every opportunity you can, like this podcast. Thank you very much. I just, you know, take it. And then if it wasn't great, then you just learn from it and, you know, don't do it again. But
and this actually occurred to me twice, where we shot a podcast interview and the interviewee did not actually like the way they came across. So we actually just shot it again. In the second one, I accidentally deleted the audio and kept the error part. And therefore, we had to reshoot the whole show again.
Oh, nice.
Well, here in Las Vegas, I actually go to a podcasters meetup that meets on the second Wednesday of every month. And according to them, they've interviewed hundreds of people back in a couple of years ago, and they've only not launched one person. And they actually interviewed her, and before they had time to launch the show, she did something that was very public and scandalous, and they thought it was in their best interest not to air that actual show.
Yeah.
And they were saying just after so many episodes that some of the shows were actually pretty good. Some of the shows weren't always that great. However, there was always some information that could be learned from each and every episode.
Right.
And like you had mentioned before, by going to the networking events, by doing these kinds of shows, there's always something that you can learn from anybody. It doesn't matter if it's at a conference, at a networking event, or even at an interview.
Yeah. And then a lot of the stuff that you need is free. You know, yes. I mean, it blows my mind that, you know, I go to these networking events and I belong to these groups, and it's like everybody wants to give me, you know, their free advice, which they charge people like hundreds of dollars for. I'm like, heck yeah, I'm going to come to your event, you know? And it's just crazy that there's so many things out there. I mean, especially because of social media, that you can educate yourself and build a business for free. There's no reason you shouldn't be successful, because it's out there. You just got to apply it.
That is absolutely true. If as long as you are open to learn or be learnable, then absolutely go to these events and learn something. When I was just starting my parent company, which is called Plentiful Perspectives, which is my entrepreneur coaching business.
Yeah.
And when I was just getting started, I ended up finding a 3-hour video on how to build a website, a WordPress website. It took me 12 hours over the course of 3 days to watch that video.
Yeah.
And it was just me hitting the replay button numerous times.
That's how I built my website.
And now I've learned that if I don't know how to do something, the easiest thing to do is either just Google it or try and find it on YouTube.
Yeah. Right. And it's like you have it at your fingertips, you know? I mean, that's why there's so many entrepreneurs in the world now, because you have it at your fingertips. If you have an idea, you know, you don't want to build somebody else's dream, build your own. So that's why I'm always going to work for myself now. Maybe not this, but I'm going to find something new. This doesn't work out.
And you're right. There is this, that time where sometimes if the business is not being profitable, you have to go and cut your losses and shut the doors. That actually reminds me of a movie. It's called Other People's Money. And then there's this monologue near the end of the movie that is actually a Danny DeVito monologue that is absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
And Danny DeVito plays this character called Larry the Liquidator, where he actually finds struggling companies. He goes out there and he buys all of their stock, and then he essentially shuts the company down and liquidates all of the pieces of the company.
Oh, geez.
And what he's doing is he goes in and buys the company and starts to let people know that this is what he's going to be doing. And he's almost seen as a bad guy in the film.
Uh-huh.
And I believe this is in a small town just outside of, say, something like Philadelphia in the Northeast. And the company is the main provider of employment in the town.
Uh-huh.
And the movie kind of makes him look like he's the bad guy, this greedy person that just wants to make money. However, honestly, I feel he was actually not the bad guy. And toward the very end of the movie, he's at a stockholders meeting where they're going to be deciding on who's going to have full control of the company. Is it going to be Larry or the current owners? And while at that meeting, he gives this monologue, and this monologue is absolutely amazing. I know you can find it on YouTube, so I would say go ahead and search on there, Other People's Money. Larry's Monologue or the one on buggy whips is another search reference that you can do.
Right, right.
But yeah, go in and just and watch the movie. It does end on a good note. However, I think you should watch the movie just because it how it describes business.
I will. Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. I'm a huge, huge movie fan. And also, just to let you know, I did write a book. It's called Designing Your Own Destiny. And it's about creating pathways to where is it that you want to be and go in your life. And this pertains to both personal and for business.
Mm-hmm.
And I did something that I've never seen in any other book.
Mm-hmm.
First off, I want to say that we all learn from three major modalities. And those are three main senses. I know we have five senses, and we don't learn always all that much from taste or smell, but we do learn from our other three senses, that being sight, sound, and touch, or better also known as kinesthetic.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And in most books that are in the personal growth industry, they tend to be more along the lines of the kinesthetic. There will be quotes like from John F. Kennedy, like Martin Luther King or Mother Teresa, or even people like Helen Keller. And most of those quotes are going to be like feel-good quotes. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah. Or,
as an example, Gandhi had a quote that said that man is the center of a circle with no circumference. And from that quote, you get a feeling from that quote.
Yeah.
But I wanted to be different. So I decided to use quotes made by fictitious people, people that did not actually exist. So let me read you one of the quotes from my book.
Okay.
And when I get to this third sentence, you're going to know exactly who said this quote.
Okay.
And here's the quote from the introduction called Embracing Change. And this is about beginning the journey along this path of this book. Here goes the quote. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I'll show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Morpheus, The Matrix, 1999.
Yeah.
And even if you didn't see the movie, the quote is still pretty powerful on its own because it's all about taking a chance to do something different. That is what the quote is about.
Right.
Now that you just heard me say the quote, did you also think about Lawrence Fishburne when he said that in the movie or even hearing his voice when he was saying it in the movie?
Yeah, but he didn't say that, right? He said something else.
No, that was actually his exact quote.
Oh, was it? Okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
To hit all three of those different modalities, all of my quotes were actually movie quotes.
Nice. That's funny. That's immediately what I thought of.
Yep. When you're seeing these quotes or reading these quotes, you're going to say, yep, I know what movie that is. And many people are going to say, yep, I've even seen that movie.
Right. Cool. Very cool. I'm going to have to get that book for sure.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. As we're about to wrap up here, are there any last words that, oh, actually, I'm sorry, I forgot. I haven't gotten the information on how people can contact you. Oops, sorry about that.
Oh, yeah.
So if people are going to try to get a hold of you or get in contact with you, this could be in regard to your speech pathology platform or program that you have, maybe your food prep business, or even the data want to be part of your database. How can they do that? Because you never know what's going to happen. So do you have something like a website or a Facebook page that they can get a hold of you at?
Yeah. So my website is www.myskool.org. And then I'm also on Facebook and Instagram. So same thing. It's on Instagram, it's LCS/, so it's learn, create, share / my school.
Could you say that again?
So it's LCS and then it's underscore and then my school, MYSCKOOL. So learn, create, share. That's what LCS stands for. And then on Facebook, it's just Facebook/ my school. My email is also it's lcs.myschool@gmail.com.
Just out of curiosity, why did you spell school with a K instead of the regular H?
I just wanted it to be unique, you know, and if you just put my school, that's people associate my school with just regular school. So I feel like kids can associate this with something that's different, that's unique, and it's theirs. So. And it catches people's eye like, oh, you're an educator and you spelled my school wrong. No, I did it on purpose. You know, it just gets conversation going. So And it just looks cooler.
Yeah, I was just curious, and I just wanted to find that out for not only for myself, but also for the audience.
Yeah.
I was just curious because since the beginning of the show, because I didn't want people going out there trying to find you and just couldn't find you anywhere because they were spelling it incorrectly.
Yeah, so I should have mentioned that early on. I forgot about that. But yeah, it's mainly came from just, you know, thinking, I mean, I believe every child is unique, so why not have a unique way of spelling it? So, because usually kids spell like school would be SK, right? That's how they would sound it out. Mm-hmm. So that's where it came from.
Yeah, I was just curious because I thought maybe the domain name wasn't available or something.
Oh, no, yeah. Everybody asked me that, too, though. No, it's just usually when I think about my kids, my special needs kids, they spell it S-K. They don't, you know, they just go S-S, you know. So it came kind of from them.
As I hinted a few moments ago, are there any last words that you want to share with the audience before we say goodbye to everybody?
You know, I just want to, you know, say that if you are a parent and even if you're not in the Bay Area, you can call me. I don't know if you're going to put it up on the podcast, but they're more willing. I'm more than willing to answer any questions. Just ask for help before you go into IEP meetings. If you're unsure if your kid has difficulties, doesn't hurt to call somebody because it's better to do it now than later because it's their future, you know, and people wait. Some parents are just not sure and they have a general education typical developing kid. And then, you know, in high school they come and they have all these difficulties you call me. So that's my one advice. It's just, if you're not sure, ask.
I'm assuming you're only working in the local Bay Area. Otherwise you're just going to have a child in front of a computer or how does that work?
Well, I do actually do sessions online. So I do actually help advocate parents, obviously on the phone. I mean, I can do anywhere across the world. And I do therapy with a couple high school kids that are in another state. They log in and whatever it might be, you know, there are less severe needs, obviously, but there's a lot of therapy that can be done. I can do pretty much any kind of therapy over the internet, believe it or not.
Well, there you go, audience. If you have a special needs person that lives in the Bay Area or even not in the Bay Area, that you could be in the U.S., could be in Canada, could be anywhere in the world, Annette could be the perfect person for you to reach out to help out to see if your kid needs any additional guidance or for to take them to the next level from what she can offer and do. Well, Annette, thank you for being on the show. I learned a lot from you, and I would actually like to talk with you a little bit about some things offline, if you don't mind.
Okay.
And Annette, thank you for being on our show. And I want to say it's been a great pleasure working or chatting with you today. And for those of you that are out there, if you also want a business coaching session, just type in your text browser, go to 40691 and type in the word consult and then the letter or the number zero. So go to 40691, consult zero, and we can set up a time for us to have a coaching session as well. So Annette, I do really appreciate you being on the show, and it's been a great pleasure having you here.
All right. Thanks. Take care.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks so much for listening to this episode of Life's Little Lessons with your host, author of Designing Your Own Destiny, Kevin A. Dunlap. For more great content and to stay up to date, visit KevinADunlap.com, Facebook.com/KevinADunlap.author, and on Twitter @KevinADunlap. We'll catch you on the next episode of Life's Little Lessons.